In this culture, there's such a tendency to push away suffering. Put the old folks here and the sick folks there and this suffering there and that suffering there. And we'll abstract and we'll label people and that'll get it out of the way. We'll call them the homeless. Then we don't have to deal with the person that's suffering.
I think it was a cry in the universe that said, no more of this, enough's enough. You know, enough's enough. And I think white, black, I think the whole planet is starting to say, enough's enough.
A lot of people really do care about what's happening. And I care, and the people around me care.
I think we're hungry for values and visions that can bring us together as communities, as families, as nations.
If the definition of power was nurturing and cooperating and helping each other to grow, I'd love to be a powerful nation. But as it is, I don't like being a powerful nation.
Overwhelmed by what we see around us, we sometimes close our hearts. This program is about reopening our hearts and reaching out in such a way that the very act of helping others nurtures ourselves.
Consist of 450,000 moving components. Unlike the human design, my functions are limited. The human design has an unlimited source that could be tapped by the opening of the heart. Unfortunately, very few humans are aware of this. There are many rare accounts of humans attaining great knowledge and wisdom. But in most cases, the species are content painting their nails and dyeing different hair particles. And reading about other people who are involved in the same level of commitment. In most cases, the child inside these creatures dies at a very young age. And as the child leaves, the heart hardens.
Robert Shields' performance was part of the Reaching Out course, which took place in Oakland, California, and attracted over 1,000 people. For 10 weeks, participants looked at how to deepen their compassion and turn it into action. The gatherings were hosted by Ram Dass, noted author, psychologist, and teacher.
There's this incredible dialogue that goes in and out. It's between the mind and the heart. See, your mind has developed a concept of who you are. It's called your ego structure. And the mind's job is to preserve that. That's your separateness, and it is the instrument of preserving your separateness. The heart, on the other hand, is this big, mushy, boundless thing. See? It doesn't know boundaries. The statement, my heart goes out to you. Somebody that's in their heart, you need it, use it. Take my car, take my house, take my life, whatever you need, use it. And the mind's saying, hey, wait a minute. Easy for you to talk about lilies of the field, but I'm responsible for paying health insurance. And you begin to see that the mind is afraid of the heart. It's afraid that your heart will give away everything. Can you imagine going around afraid of your own heart? Well, that's what we are. Because the mind, the intellectual mind, doesn't trust intuitive wisdom because it doesn't know what it's talking about. And intuitive wisdom allows you to honor everything in the situation, which is your unique predicament, and then you don't give away everything unless it's appropriate to give away everything. And we're experiencing the possibility that the spontaneous generosity of our heart can be reclaimed. And it need not be at the mercy of the frightened mind.
Those who attended the Reaching Out course were encouraged to take risks, to go out into their community, to begin helping others, and to bring back to the auditorium what they learned. In this hour, we will hear some of their stories. Suffering
you have to take care of your own suffering before you can move on to someone else's. Because if you're not taking care of yourself, then you'll collapse while you're taking care of someone else. I think that's almost the key to trying to help others.
Yeah, the problem with that, though, is for you to end your own suffering completely before you help someone else, they should wait so long, you see? So, I mean, it's true. What you got to do is end up doing both of them at once. You got to work on yourself, and you've also got to help others, because the helping others is part of the way you work on your stuff and yourself. And that's part of what we're trying to figure out, how to make those both work to our advantage.
Though he has an Eastern name, Ram Dass is very much a Westerner. As Dr. Richard Alpert, he taught psychology at Harvard and was a key figure in research on consciousness. He continued this research by traveling to Nepal and India to study Buddhism and Hinduism. When he returned, he wrote Be Here Now, which helped integrate Eastern spirituality into Western thought.
But when I was in India, where I got the name Ram Dass, and I was with a very wise and very beautiful spiritual teacher, Neem Karoli Baba, when I said to him, how can I get enlightened? He said, feed people. So I thought something got lost in the translation. So I tried it a different tack. I said, how can I know God? And he said, serve people. He said that in 1970, and I didn't really want to hear it. It wasn't a path that was attractive to me. I wanted secret magical incantations and deep practices in Himalayan caves. But no matter how hard I tried to avoid it, karma being what it is, I realized by the mid-70s that my path through to liberation was going to be one of service. And the richness of coming together around the intention to relieve suffering is so profound that I have wanted to share it with many people. And in a way, this is my opportunity to do just that.
The evenings also featured Bobby McFerrin, Peter Gabriel, and other performers who volunteered their creative talents to help inspire course participants. Further support came from small group discussions like this one.
It was hard because it's like you had to lock your windows and lock your doors. You literally had to dodge bullets. I mean, bullets in the back door, bullets in the car. I mean, you're living with a lot of fear. I mean, there's enough to see in a block and a half that if you went with your total heart all open, you're overwhelmed. So you don't.
I see the same thing in my neighborhood. I see my people, you know, suffering, you know, and I say, well, what can I do to change this? How can I change myself? You know, so I stay in my head because I'm hurt, you know, and then when I get into my heart, you know, I have to move out of it. You know, I have to move out of it. I can't stay there very long because it's too painful.
I'm a very in the head person because as soon as I'm in the heart, I'm mush.
Yeah, you know, it's like, there's pain.
And I can't be effective when I'm in my heart too much. And I don't know how to have my heart continually be able to be broken and not get burned out.
In the service work that that I've been doing, it's not quite as visibly kind of desperate as, you know, walking down the street and seeing crack houses and all that. So for me, I can have an open heart, at least I think I do. But whenever I go into my head and think, geez, what I'm doing really isn't that big a deal when you look at the grand scale of things. So when I go into my head, that's when I start getting kind of desperate.
I've tried to open up my heart more towards my business dealings. And I found, you know, versus the pain that maybe you're experiencing, I've experienced an incredible amount of fear, you know, as people like are going to rip me off, take advantage of me. I guess what I've kind of learned from this course is if I can move to that heart position and try to function from that, it'll open up possibilities.
This is basically a course of the heart. You and I start with such incredible heart space, and then it closes down out of fear and the mind takes over. And we're coming back to that space again. There is a way that as you and I find out how to reach out and be reached out to, how to move through those boundaries that only the heart knows that route. As we find that our hearts are fed in a way that there is very little modeling about in the society.
To provide role models for the course participants, Ram Dass taped interviews with spiritual, cultural, and business leaders, including Reverend Jim Wallace.
So what's happening, I think, is a lot of people, even outside of religion per se, are realizing that underneath all of these social, economic, and political issues, there's a spiritual core at the heart of our relationship to the poor, to the earth, to one another. These are spiritual issues.
Reverend Jim Wallace is a civil rights activist, editor of Sojourners Magazine, and the director of the Sojourners Neighborhood Center, an organization serving the homeless of Washington, D.C.
At the heart of all the issues that we all struggle with, homelessness, hungry people, what we've lost is a basic sense of solidarity with one another. In my neighborhood, a whole generation of young people is being lost to drugs and poverty and violence. A whole generation of us is being wiped out. But white America doesn't see it that way. It's them. It's a crime problem, an issue of urban violence. But it's us who are being destroyed. There is no them anymore. The world's too small for that. It's only we. And unless we can reestablish our connection with one another, then we really don't have any future to speak of.
You have no walls. In the thunder crash, you're a thousand miles within a flash. Don't be afraid to cry what you see. The actor's gone, there's only you and me.
In this culture, there's such a tendency to push away suffering. Put the old folks here and the sick folks there and this suffering there and that suffering there. And we'll abstract and we'll label people, and that'll get it out of the way. We'll call them the homeless. Then we don't have to deal with the person that's suffering. But when you push suffering away, you push a part of yourself away. You armor yourself against what is. You're not accepting the way things are. Because you're afraid. I'm afraid. To me, this course is a tiny bit of the process in all of our lives. It isn't that we all walk out of here or finish the television series and we're all metamorphized, transformed into something we don't recognize. But there is a wearing away like water on stone that's going on, where you're slowly, slowly coming to terms with the suffering, coming to terms with what your skills, what you could do, coming to terms with what inner growth you need. You're just aligning yourself into a place that feels more harmonious, where your heart can find expression in this society.
But how can we begin that process? Ram Dass spoke with environmental activist Carl Anthony, president of the Earth Island Institute.
How do you say to somebody that says, what do I do? What do you tell them? Is it not a thing you say? I mean, what I say to people is, get all the information and then listen to your own heart as to what you do. I don't know what else to say.
There's a statement from the Bible that says, physician, heal thyself. And I would say that we really do need to find the harmony within ourselves and our being, because if we operate from a place of lack of personal balance, then there's no way that we can possibly bring harmony into our surroundings. And this is very difficult, and I certainly feel that it's a worthy journey. In my way of thinking, that there really needs to be a balance between finding that peace within oneself and then acting on the external world to see, to test what we've found. Each of us knows where we are. And if we take the time to listen to those small, quiet voices that tell us, rather than the big advertising signs, I think we may be able to be on the journey.
Ram Dass spoke with Dolores Huerta about her journey. Dolores, mother of 11 children, started the United Farm Workers with Cesar Chavez.
Is that when you're doing this type of work, it's like you never really know what's ahead, because it's like they're like new paths, like going into a jungle, right?
Yeah.
But you just have to have faith that you're going in the right direction.
Right.
And if you're not going in the right direction, or you make a mistake, that's okay. You made a mistake and just turn around and go in another
just
direction.
Correct it. Yes.
Just correct it, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
But that doesn't keep you, or it shouldn't stop you from going on ahead and trying to do things. And as you learn new strategies and tactics, and certainly I've seen that in the union, you know, like when we first thought about organizing farm workers, neither Cesar or myself even thought about boycotts. And it was in a casual conversation in fact, it was a Berkeley attorney, a fellow named Stu Weinberg, who said, well, why don't we try boycotting grapes or something? Or boycotts. Why don't we try boycotts, he said. So we did. We started boycotting individual labels and individual doors, and eventually the total grape boycott. But that's, you know, the answers come when you, you know, go down the path and open the door, take the other path, and then another answer will come. But none of them come unless you actually start doing something.
But for some in the Reaching Out course, taking the first step of doing something they hadn't done before was scary. Amy Kaminer spent the first few weeks of the course just gaining the courage to begin volunteering.
I ended up deciding to work at the Women's Daytime Drop-In Center, which is a volunteer-run home in Berkeley. One of the things that was the scariest for me when I first decided to go there was knowing that there wasn't a staff person that was going to be there all the time. And it's you and another volunteer, and anything that happens in the house, you and the women who are there have to deal with it.
And I know when you come to Acton, you guys feed us, and you give us something that we can
eat. When Stephanie came into the center, she clearly was hurting. And so when someone's in that much pain and had lost all of her belongings and had recently been raped, you don't always know what to do with that. It's, you know, your first reaction is to like hug someone or pat them. And so I think one of the things is just to somehow learn to be there and to listen.
Yeah. And I don't have nothing in it, but I got one sleeping bag, a pillow, and me.
And to realize that you don't necessarily have to say anything, but to just believe what they're saying is truth. And I think it's hard sometimes to remember not to be judgmental about what someone chooses to do and to just try and listen. It's something I struggle with because I want to do something. I'm someone, I don't like pain, I don't like suffering, and I like to fix things. I don't even like conflict. I mean, I'm someone that in general tries to smooth things over and make everything nice and tidy again. So it's been a challenge.
It's clear when you look at people like Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, and so many people who were out on the leading edge of action, they placed considerable stress on their inner work. Because you understand that if you get so pained and so angry and so offended and so crushed, you become debilitated in your ability to really help other human beings and to reduce suffering. So you begin to see the pattern that you work on yourself as an offering to become a more effective instrument for the relief of suffering. When we start to recognize the need for inner work or inner growth, each of us listens to hear what are their predilections, what are the determining factors within you that determine what your route is to do inner work. Because there are many, many routes up the mountain. And the interesting thing is they all lead to the top. There is a pathway, however, that's particularly of interest to me because it takes my yearning to serve and to relieve suffering, and it makes the actions I perform towards that end the very stuff of my inner work. It's called the path of action, or in Eastern way, it's called karma yoga.
The path of action is familiar to people from many religious traditions. Brother David Stendel-Rost, a Benedictine monk, explains it in Christian terms.
Most people think of contemplation as somehow, the image is going up onto the mountain and exposing yourself to the vision. Now, a contemplation in action,
yes,
stresses that in the very process of acting, you get the vision.
That's what I'm interested in.
That you find the divine in the acting.
Yeah.
And that is experiencing the divine spirit as flowing through you and animating the action. See? So where you find the divine when you practice contemplation in action is in the very love that you put into your action, in the very care with which you perform your action. I've often talked with people who so obviously were so dedicated to their work and to their service and were doing this all the time, and then would say to me, look, we are working all these hours with the sick or with the dying or with the children or something like that. We don't even have time for prayer. And I would say, well, you don't have any time for distractions, but what you're doing is prayer all the time.
Well, David is referring to these two ways of looking at the inner and the outer. One is where you pull back to do the inner, go up the mountain, and then you come back with that kind of equanimity and wisdom and love and presence, and then you work out in the world. And then the second one is the contemplation in action, where the very doing of the act keeps bringing you closer inwardly at the same moment you're doing the outer work. It's like a self-sharpening tool, because as you serve somebody and you do it in a way that is a process of working on yourself, you become clearer and quieter and more present and able to listen more deeply. And as you're able to do all that, you're able to serve better.
You're right out on the line. And you're on the line in the place you live and in all the kind of social movements you've been in, civil rights, Vietnam, anti-Vietnam. How do you do that? What resources do you have? How does it work in you that you don't get reactive?
I think it's a daily struggle to maintain your own center, the peace that we long and hope for, really does begin in our own heart, our own soul. But I almost want to say in your own guts. To me, it means I really do have to just stop and be quiet sometimes, and I have to be careful that I don't get so caught up in the political fray and the press and political strategy that I forget why I'm doing what I'm doing. It all comes home for me in Jesus' words when he says, as you have done to the least of these, you have done to me.
Helping the homeless is one way that many have put their beliefs into action. In New York City's Lower East Side, Trinity Church runs a center that feeds the homeless. Jim Wallace describes a similar program at the Sojourner Neighborhood Center.
Every Saturday morning, the doors open and there's a food line. Ordinary people stand in line for a bag of groceries to help get them through the week. And just before the doors open, all those who have been preparing the food and getting it ready join hands and say a prayer. And these are neighborhood people, by and large, who were in the food line originally and still take that bag of groceries home every week, but now run the program. Now, Mary Glover is an old black woman who offers the prayer, because she's our best prayer. and she prays like someone who knows to whom she's talking. She's been praying for a long time. And she gives thanks, a woman who has almost nothing. She's herself very poor. She says, Lord, we know that you'll be coming through this line today. So Lord, help us to treat you well. Help us to treat you well.
Nice.
Now, she understands that in her relationship to those brothers and sisters coming through that line, that that's even more important than the food they're going to get.
Another person who appreciates the value of building relationship is Reaching Out Course member Roberto Vargas. Roberto speaks of how his perspective on activism has changed over the past 25 years.
I was part of the 60s where it was political activism. There was, if you're doing your work right, you're on the picket line, you're at the demonstration, there's no time for family, there's no time for self, there's no time for spirit. That's one of our mistakes. I mean, we wanted to create a new world now, and it meant kind of hard line, hit hard kind of activism. Yet reality is, it's like, it's more than that. If you want a new world, you need to have new institutions, and new institutions mean new people. And people relating to each other in different ways. So it goes back to the person. If we want a better world, we need better people. We need more loving, caring people who know how to be loving, caring in their relationships, who know how to be loving, caring as a family. So that means being with my children in such a way so I help them develop their confidence and their well-being, honoring their thoughts. So they begin to trust their own feeling. I remember one time I was going to go speak to a youth group, and I was struggling with what am I going to share with this group. And I turned around to my daughter, I think she's around 3 years old at the time, and I told her, Mijas, what do you think I should tell them? And the first thing she said, Papa, diles que tienen corazón, y el poder es en el corazón. She said, tell them that they have heart, and their power is in the heart.
Gracias, gran Creador, por todo que somos y todo que tenemos, por este día y por los días que vienen. Gracias que estamos aquí para hacer esto otra vez.
In 1990, Roberto and his family moved from a Chicano neighborhood in Oakland to Castro Valley, California, a predominantly white middle-class town.
You're presenting your class, maybe
when his daughters experienced racism in their new school, Roberto took action. Learning from his experience in the 60s, Roberto decided to work for change within the system by building relationships that crossed ethnic lines. He volunteered at his daughter's new school.
That's what we're modeling, is that your experience is your teacher. And you're your children's teacher. We just need to organize your ideas.
He worked step by step, first with parents and then with the students, in an attempt to break down stereotypes and create a positive attitude toward his Chicano Indio culture.
How it looks. Okay, great. Okay, what else can we do? Yes. Pick up garbage. What I try to bring is one kind of knowledge, experience of Chicanos. So these children see Chicanos not just as lowrider folks that do graffiti and walls, but people that are concerned about the healing of Earth, and people that are concerned about with other people, and that we learn how to care. Because that's part of my culture. We're a very caring culture. We have a lot of corazón, a lot of heart. And I want people to know that.
Roberto and his wife Rebecca eventually volunteered to organize an Earth Day ceremony at the school based on the traditions from their culture.
As we face the north, let's think of those in our family, those elders who can give us special advice, who can help us in some way to heal the planet.
Okay, when we think about ourselves, we're spirit people. We're part of the great creation. We're all here together, and spirit is a very important part of our lives. Afterwards, this one girl came to me and she said, you know what? It's like we stood in the rain for the earth. And for her, it was like we made a commitment. We demonstrated, not as an individual. She said, we stood in the rain.
Sometimes it takes a rainy day just to let you know.
Which act do you do? Because a vast amount of suffering everywhere. You work in a soup kitchen, or do you work on legislation? Do you meditate to help the world? Or do you go overseas to do something? You get special training? Do you use one skill or another? In the sea of immense suffering, and in the complexity of all your skills, talents, opportunities, values, limitations, the best way is to intuitively go inside, hear the whole thing as well as you can, and then feel your way into what seems like an appropriate action.
Ruth Brinker, a widow and mother of two, ran her own antiques business until a friend of hers contracted the AIDS virus. Then, a whole new world opened up for her.
I suddenly realized that there were all these people throughout the city that had AIDS. And if not even my friend, with his vast army of friends,
could count on getting the help he needed every single day. What was happening to all these other people? So I just felt compelled to start a program to serve them. And at the beginning, I would find people on the floor when I got into their apartments. They had only had the strength to crawl to where the buzzer was, pull them up, and buzz me in, yeah, and I would have to help them back in the bed.
How did your heart deal with that?
I felt such compassion for them, and it was painful to see them, but I felt that if I had not started the program, they would have died, not of AIDS, but of malnutrition. People would tell me that they would prop themselves up by the stove trying to warm up a can of soup. Or they would be lying in bed and on a very hot day and wonder whether they should open the window or whether they should go to the kitchen. They didn't have the energy to do both. Now we don't see that very much anymore because people know they can call us and we'll bring meals to them.
What Ruth Brinker began has grown into Project Open Hand, a $2 million a year program that feeds 2,000 people every day and involves hundreds of volunteers.
Where do the volunteers come from?
Absolutely everywhere. We have a cross-section of the city. We're a real melting pot. We have 12-year-old boys coming up on skateboards who say they want to help make sandwiches. We have very social ladies. We have senior citizens. We have the gamut. It's a wonderful feeling.
It does feel good to know you're doing something that helps. But sometimes in helping others, we encounter suffering which overwhelms us. Mary Beaton, an artist and mother of two children, speaks of her experiences with reaching out.
I started working with the kids who were waiting in the emergency room to be seen. There was one mother who came in with her child, and I looked at her, and the mother had bruises all over her face, and the child had bruises on her face too, and a bandage, and I have no idea what the woman's life was like, but I knew that it was pretty horrible, and you could see the pain in her eyes and the child's eyes, and one of my first reactions was, oh no, don't look at that, that's too sad, you can't look at that, it'll tear you apart from what you're doing, and I don't know what else to say, but that it was just incredibly moving to see that and to feel that and to see that child, and also really sad, and I didn't know what to do with the sadness. That's the part that I don't know where do you go from there? You look at this and you see it, and what do we do with it? How can we help people in those situations?
Your effect to relieve suffering is colored by the way in which you react to suffering. You see that the qualities of mind, the content of the mind, affects our compassion towards others. Now, when you go to change all this, you can change the content through education. But the root problem is even deeper than that. And the root problem was enunciated by the Buddha after he got enlightened. And he gave the first sermon, in which he enunciated the Four Noble Truths. And the first truth he enunciated was, there is suffering. That's it. It's a far-out statement. It's the first truth of wisdom. There is suffering. Birth, suffering, death, sickness, old age, all suffering. And then the second truth was the cause of suffering is the clinging of mind. That is, if the mind doesn't cling at something, like I was 60. Now, If I'm clinging to being 40, I am really miserable now. But if I say, 60, so. Okay. Now I can become wise. Okay. Took the same phenomenon. Stopped clinging to a model of who I was. The third noble truth was that if you let go of the clinging of mind, you end suffering. Your own, by the way. And the fourth noble truth is what is called the Eightfold Path, or his method of doing that. But the predicament is you can't wait till you're enlightened to do something. So you start to act to relieve other people's suffering, still a complete mess yourself. And then you figure out how to use the situation in two ways, one to help another person and one to work on yourself. Let me ask you now, those of you that have been doing some volunteer or service work, what traps have you run into? What things have caught you?
After the second evening here, I was outside of a Safeway in Santa Rosa going home, and there was a homeless gentleman outside, and gee, he was outside Safeway. I figured he was hungry. So I left Safeway with a gallon of milk and a bag of kiwis. I said, man, looks like he could use a kiwi. I went over to this older man, he's probably about 60 years old, and I said, here's a kiwi. He says, what's that? I said, well, it's kind of like a large green strawberry. And I said, it's really good and sweet, and it's very beautiful. So he looked at it for a moment, and he looked me straight in the eye, and he said, I have absolutely no use for this at all. I was totally set back by it, and I've thought about it a lot every day since then with everybody that I pass who looks hungry. And it's really not how hungry they are or what their hunger may be about. It's you really have to know what people want in order to help them. And if you find yourself, I was trying to do it that night because I was so reaching out, you know, I was so full of all the reaching out. You really need to know that you're helping people for them from a place that isn't for you.
Yeah.
Or at least for both of you, so you get started in the giving where you're not in the giving.
These teenagers also attended the Reaching Out course, but their exploration into giving had begun earlier. Encouraged by a program at Los Gatos High School, these students have taken an active role to promote environmental changes in their school and community.
But our system places so much emphasis on information and so little emphasis on action. What we really need to do is to give the students a sense of their own power so that they go out into the world as an active learner and an active contributor, so that they become empowered and they go out into the world and can make a difference.
Spotters ready?
All right, Dave.
To gain a feeling of empowerment, these students are tackling a ropes course in the woods where they experience both fear and trust. The students are faced with personal challenges that help build their self-confidence as well as their ability to support and care for one another. David Torzan explains.
When I went into it, I was afraid because I'm afraid of heights and things, but then I knew that I could trust the people holding the ropes. I knew that I could trust the people who were spotting me, and I knew that there was trust all the way through it. And that wiped off one whole section of my fear. I think I learned when you're trying to work with someone what the important things are, that you communicate, that you know how they're feeling and they can feel how you're feeling, and that you work together and cooperate. And knowing that all those other people were behind me gave me confidence for myself.
When I look at the kids I work with, I see
that they don't have the screens that a lot of adults have up. A lot of people really do care about what's happening, and I care, and the people around me care.
Allie, David, and other classmates who attended the Reaching Out course chose for their service project to go to elementary schools with a skit about water conservation.
So I'm going to introduce you to two more people, and their names are Water Cool and Water Fool. And at the end of their little skit, I want you guys to tell me who was who, okay? So, here we go.
Well, not just that, but we're going to need a little help in this skit because we didn't want to waste water in the first place, so we made our nifty little faucet.
Let's see, now I have to brush my teeth.
When an imaginary spigot was turned on, the kids made water sounds to emphasize how much water is wasted doing everyday things like brushing your teeth.
I'm all done.
Okay, now here's another one of my friends.
And I'm all done.
When she was washing her face, she could turn off the water and then, like...
For me, it was really important to let them know that they, even as elementary school kids, had the power and had the voice to affect what was happening to the planet.
Each of you can help out in saving the Earth. And a good friend of mine once said, he said, there are no passengers on spaceship Earth. So come on, everyone, let's get to work.
I had a chance to take a look at it for myself and bring it back home and saying, oh, you know, I have the power to change things too.
Allie and David were taught helping skills at their high school, but what about the rest of us? If we're going to make changes in the world, what techniques can we use to foster change in ourselves?
The cultivation of the witness is one of the techniques. That is, cultivating a part of the mind that is watching all the rest of it. It isn't judging. It isn't trying to change anything. It's just present, and it's noticing. Now, often when you're doing some kind of an act of service, you will get uptight, you'll get frustrated because you can't bring about the effect you want. The part of you that's the witness will notice, ah, uptight. It doesn't say you shouldn't be uptight. It doesn't try to change anything. It just notices how it is. Now, the predicament is that in the heat of the action, you forget. The fascination with the work you're doing to relieve suffering will often lead you to forget that you are working on yourself. And all that happens over time when you keep cultivating the witness is that you remember sooner and sooner and sooner. Then there's another one, which is good, which is examine how many models and expectations you have about what's going to happen. And realize you don't really know the first thing about what's going to happen. It's a great story, you know, about the farmer who had a horse, and the horse ran away, and the neighbor said, oh, isn't that too bad? And the farmer says, you never know. And the next day, the horse came back, followed by a beautiful wild stallion. And the neighbor said, how fortunate. And the farmer said, you never know. And shortly thereafter, the son of the farmer was riding the wild horse, and he fell and broke his leg. And the neighbor said, isn't that terrible? And the farmer said, you never know. Shortly thereafter, the government was coming through conscripting the young men for service. Because the boy had a broken leg, he was left behind. And the neighbor said, how fortunate. And the farmer said,
yeah. Sometimes letting go of our expectations can help us get a larger perspective. Not only can we redefine how we see others, but also how we see our jobs. Ice cream makers Ben and Jerry found coping with the enormous success of their company required changing how they viewed business.
you know, the original idea was that Jerry and I were going to have this homemade ice cream parlor around the corner, and it was never going to be anything more than that.
So we wanted to get together and work for ourselves and be our own bosses. And then so then to be put in a position where we had our own company and we were other people's bosses was sort of a switch.
So when it started growing and we turned around and looked at ourselves and said, well, look what's going on here. We're not ice cream men anymore. We're businessmen. Our first reaction was to sell it. When I eventually changed that decision and decided to keep the business, it was because I had run into this kind of older, somewhat eccentric guy named Maurice Purpura, who had been a restaurateur, and he said, well, you know, if you don't want your business to exploit and you find problems with business, why don't you just change your business so that it doesn't do those things?
That we wanted to have what we finally ended up calling linked prosperity, that as the company prospers, everybody prospers.
At Ben & Jerry's, we have what we call a two-part bottom line, and our success is measured both by how much money is left over at the end of the year, traditional profit, and by how much have we improved the quality of life for the community.
For 15 years, Ben and Jerry have applied their two-part bottom line to many communities. Recently, they opened a store employing the homeless in Harlem.
We find more and more, we learn more and more as we're in business over the years, that there is a spiritual aspect to business just as there is to the lives of individuals. And that as you help others, as individuals or as a business, you end up helping yourself.
I've thought about what I've learned in preparing material and in listening and in forming this course. I think it became clear to us in the course of our discussions that our fear of loss of boundary was a real issue. That we were afraid that if we opened our heart to what is around us, we would be devoured or destroyed or be emptied. And what this kind of reflection that we have been doing does for me is it forces me to find the way to be in the presence of that suffering and know how to set the limits to honor my separateness and my uniqueness. Learning how to say no without closing the heart. Great teaching, great thing to figure out. And we reflected together about something called the path of action. A technique where as you reach out to other people, you do that as work on your inner growth. And as you grow inwardly, you are more effective in the way in which you serve other people. And that circle just keeps going around and around and around. Some people leaped into action to do good. And then they saw that the action of reaching out to another person is far more than doing good. It's a process in which one meets another being. And in that process, when it is done with good heart, everybody benefits and everybody grows.
But for any growth to occur, one more thing is needed: our willingness to try.
Between impossibility and possibility, between what is now and what is future, between the old and the new, there's always a door. And that door is hope. The critical question is, who will walk through the door? Only those who believe there is something on the other side and are willing to ground their lives in the belief that something is there to which they'll commit themselves,
they'll risk
that they
change,
can't see.
And they'll risk change.
And those who walk through the door always pay a price.
Yeah, exactly.
They're the ones who sacrifice
exactly.
And risk. And once they go through the door, then it becomes more possible for others to walk through.
Sure,
those who sat at the lunch counters for SNCC, those who marched and struggled and paid the price for things that now we all take for granted. That happens again and again. And here's where the question of faith of some kind becomes so important. Because to risk and sacrifice
what you got and pay for the what price you don't know takes faith.
Takes faith.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah.
My best definition of hope is this, that hope and faith is believing in spite of the evidence and watching the evidence change.
Wise men say only fools relish in, but I can't help falling in love with you. But I like singing these little love songs every once in a while. Because I noticed in the midst of crises, you know, it's the ordinary little things that go first. There's a lot of people still away from home tonight or ill tonight or something who miss those ordinary things. So here's an ordinary love song. I hope you can sing it with me, I think. It sounds great in this place. You don't have to know the words. I'll give them to you. Goes, wise men say, wise men say, only fools rush in. Only fools rush in. Because I can't help falling in love with you. Because I can't falling in love. Good.